following lecture was produced by Glorian Publishing, a nonprofit organization, and is one of hundreds of lectures freely available via download, podcasts, streaming radio, and transcription. These lectures range in topic and complexity in order to address the many needs of humanity. We invite you to browse our library of lectures, books, courses, and articles to find teachings that suit you. Through the support of donations, Glorian Publishing has published 40 books, hosts international retreats several times a year, offers free online courses, and many other valuable resources, available to anyone worldwide. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Your donations make it possible for this free public service to reach thousands of people every day. To make a tax-deductible donation in any amount, even anonymously, visit GnosticTeachings.org. Now, with heartfelt wishes for the end of suffering for all creatures, we begin the lecture. May all beings be happy.
We are arriving at the point when we have to explain in detail, as much as we can, the nature of that which is divine in each one of us, related with the macrocosmos and the microcosmos. As you notice, we, the Gnostics, work intensely with the Holy Spirit, with the Divine Mother, and precisely the lecture of today is entitled The Eightfold Path and the Pentalpha. The five aspects of the Divine Mother, because we had to study the Divine Mother since God is male-female, and this lecture is dedicated to our Divine Mother Kundalini. If you go into the home of our webpage, you will find in the very bottom the title of this course, which is The Transformation of Energy. You click there, and then you will find this lecture, which is called The Eightfold Path and the Pentalpha. Click there, and then you will find the images which are necessary for you to study and to see in order to comprehend the different topics of this lecture. Always, as we know, we are going to start from above, but little by little we are going to descend. So please pay attention, because since we are blind, asleep, it's very difficult for us to understand the aspects of God, divinity, and even the CET, which is called the Absolute. To begin, we will say that the Master Samael mentions very often in his books Shiva. And he states that Shiva is the first begotten, the Holy Spirit, the super monad, the first begotten of creation, and that in the depth all of us have that Shiva. In the Hindu theology, we study how from Shiva emerges the universe. If you see the image that is there, in the website, you will see the image of Shiva Shakti with the mantra Om written in Sanskrit. And of course, between Shiva Shakti, they are making the sign of the infinite. The infinite is the sign that synthesizes the two forces, whether within the absolute or out of the absolute. Hinduism says that the first begotten of creation is Shiva. And they call it Shiva Narayana, which, of course, Narayana is an aspect of the water. This Shiva Narayana is unmanifested, and from him emerges creation. But there is, of course, the Divine Mother Shiva as well, that usually we call Shakti. So Shiva Shakti are the two aspects of Shiva, the male Shiva and the female Shiva. But in reality, they are not gods, but deities. This is the abstract deity, which abides within the absolute. The sign of the infinite symbolizes the three primary forces, the brain, the heart, and the sex, which are always in a latent state within every Ein Sof. So the Ein Sof itself is that aspect from which the universe emerged. The universe also return into the Ein Sof, as in Hinduism, they state that Shiva is creator and destroyer. But we have to understand that creation is hidden within the female aspect of that Ein Sof, which in Kabbalah is called Sephirah, the mother of the Sephiroth. It is good to remember that according to Kabbalah, the name of God has four letters, Yod, He, Vav, He. And if you remember, we always say that the last He is a repetition of the second, Yod, He, Vav, He. And that last He is a symbol of that Ein Sof, which is the uterus from where the Trinity always emerges. So that's why we say that God is the tetragrammaton, the four letters, obviously representing the three primary forces that are manifested in the universe, and the unmanifested part of it, which is Shiva Shakti, from where the universe emerged. That's why when we talk about Shiva, we have to understand that we also can apply the Holy Spirit or the Force of Creation, Shiva, into the unknowable, in order to explain how creation emerges from the unknown. Why do we say always that the Ein Sof is the unknowable? We say that because it is unknowable for us. But when the absolute becomes knowable to itself, and then that Ein Sof becomes an entity that is named in Sanskrit Paramartha Satya, Paramartha Satya, the absolute is something known. But for us, it's unknown. And if that becomes known for us, then we will become Paramartha Satyas. So within that feminine aspect of Shiva, or the Ein Sof, which is called Sephira, within the absolute, is where we find that which in Sanskrit is called gunas. The gunas are aspects, principles of the Divine Mother, which is unmanifested. It is written that when the three gunas, sattva, rajas, and tamas, are in balance, that, of course, is because the universe is in repose within the Ein Sof. The universe does not exist when these three qualities of the Divine Mother, called also in Sanskrit Prakriti, is in balance. These three gunas contain within themselves that which in Sanskrit is called vikritis, or modifications, which express themselves to the tattvas that we were talking in different lectures. The tattvas are modifications of the three gunas, or the Divine Mother. So when these three aspects, sattva, rajas, and tamas, which is synthesized in knowledge, emotion, and action, enter in this equilibrium, and then forcefully the universe should and must appear. Why do these three aspects of the Divine Mother enter in this equilibrium? Because these three gunas, or aspects of the Divine Mother, the female aspect of Shiva, the Ein Sof, are the principles within which all the possibilities of creation exist. As we told you in the other lecture, in the beginning, that within the Ein Sof, within the monad, exist all the infinite possibilities of creation. But we have to develop that. In other words, the Ein Sof needs to develop those possibilities. And in order to acquire knowledge, in order to acquire absolute consciousness of itself. So within the Ein Sof, that longing of knowing itself exists, and then the Divine Mother enter in this equilibrium and creates the universe, because through the universe is the only way in which the Ein Sof can know itself or can develop vikritis, all the infinite possibilities of creation. That three aspect or aspects of the Divine Mother are represented in the chakra Muladhara. When we say that the Kundalini, which is dormant in the chakra Muladhara, is coiled 3.5 times. The 3 times are related with the three gunas that we had to control. And the half part of that serpent is vikritis, the possibilities that will develop according with our internal spiritual development. To comprehend this is important, because these three gunas are controlled or should be controlled by every single monad individually. And there are many levels in which these monads express the control of the three gunas. From the very bottom to the very top, the highest of the monads that are on top of the pyramid is what we call gods or cosmo creators. That they control these three gunas according to their development or evolution in previous days, cosmic days. And they express them, the knowledge and everything, through themselves. The beginners, those that just emerged from the Absolute for the first time, as you know, have to learn how to develop those possibilities with the help of those which are already there on top. When somebody, as the Master Jesus of Nazareth, Master Avramento, acquires absolute control of the three gunas, it's because he has acquired absolute consciousness of his own self, and therefore becomes a Paramarta Satya. That is the goal of the Absolute. The Divine Mother, that's why, is symbolized by the waters. It is stated that in the beginning, the Spirit of God was moving over the surface of the waters. Those waters have always a symbol in Aquarius of the M, which is the symbol in Latin of the word mater, which in English is mater, mother. And that M also goes into Kabbalah with the letter Mem, which symbolizes water. And that's why the Divine Mother in Christianity is called Mary, because is Mem, the water. The unmanifested Mary, as you see in the graphics that we place in the internet, is precisely in the center of the second graphic. The unmanifested mother is the space, is that which is called Akas or Akasa, which means heaven, the space. That substance, Akasa, within the unmanifested absolute, is the wife of Shiva, the unmanifested Shiva, the creator, which we can call Prana. So Prana and Akas, energy and matter, in substance. Because when we said matter, the substance of matter, which is called Prakriti, is that divine mother which has no form. It's diluted in the space. And she, of course, is intelligence. From her emerges the universe. That's why we say that the universe emerges from the Ein Sof and returns to the Ein Sof. The universe emerges from the Divine Mother, from the womb of the Divine Mother, the unmanifested, and returned into the unmanifested Mother. And that's why you find there that in the bosom of the Divine Mother space, which is in the center of the second graphic, you find that there are the three aspects of Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva, which in previous lecture we explained that every monad, every Ein Sof within itself has its three atoms that has to develop, that has to control the gunas. That's why we will say that the gunas are within the absolute, within the womb of the Divine Mother. But the absolute is not within the goodness. This is something that we have to understand. Because when the absolute is within the goodness, and then you have aparamarta satya. And that's precisely the objective of the universe. For the Ein Sof to be within the goodness, and only to become knowable to itself. And, of course, these three gunas could symbolize with the three colors, blue, yellow, and red, in order to comprehend that from these three primary colors emerges creation, all the colors, all the lights, sounds. And the goal of the three primary forces, Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva, of every single monad is to control the three gunas. We are going to make a pause here because our technician is telling us that he fixed the problem. Maybe. We will see. Which is beyond the Ein Sof, the abstract, absolute space. That's why we are here. That's the only reason why we are created, or we emerge from the absolute. That's why you find that there are different levels of the being. And each one of us in the depth has its own level, according with its own development, which has to be through willpower, through the activity of the Divine Mother. So, when the Divine Mother creates the universe, when the universe emerges, that's why you find a variety of suns, planets, moons. Each one of them individually have their own particular mother nature, which is the second aspect. This second aspect is represented by the Greeks with Diana, the hunter, which, as you see, is in the right bottom of the graphic. Diana represents the Divine Mother Nature, which also is represented in many religions as Tonantzin, Rhea, Cibeles, Isis. Between parentheses, Isis in the ancient Egypt is symbolized as the uncreated Divine Mother and the created Divine Mother, the manifested and the unmanifested. And in Christianity, they call it Mary. I mean, they call it the three Marys, related with these aspects of the Divine Mother. So, the Divine Mother nature in the planet Earth is placed in the fourth dimension. And she is represented in the mother of Jesus of Nazareth, called Mary or Miriam. And it's also called the Virgin of Carmel. The Virgin of the Sea, Stella Maris. Of course, as a great diva, or female aspect of God, which is related with nature. So our own nature, our own planet Earth, as far as is God, is a goddess. Gaia, or Gia, according to the Greeks. It has different names and different religions. She is abiding in Eden, the fourth dimension. She's the one that welcomes all of those who are completely dead, psychologically speaking. Those that have worked intensely with the Divine Mother Death, which is the other aspect, cosmic aspect. Because if the universe emerges from the unmanifested Kundalini, Maha Kundalini, returns there when the Divine Mother Death annihilates the life of all of those cosmic units. That's why you see that the Divine Mother Death with her scythe is precisely in the very head of the uncreated, because the universe also dies. The death of the universe is called pralaya, or the cosmic night in which the cosmic day finishes. And we're not talking about the Divine Mother Death. It comes into my mind Saturn. Saturn, Kronos, the first begotten of creation. Kronos, Saturn, as you know, in Kabbalah, controls the Sephirah Binah, the Holy Spirit. And Saturn is also symbolized with a scythe. Obviously, Shiva, the Holy Spirit, the manifested one, as his wife, Mother Death, when in the Saturn aspect, because in his creative aspect within nature, as his wife as well. And Parvati, this is the two wives of Shiva, Parvati and Uma, symbolizing the two aspects that we are talking here in relation with Mother Death. Of course, we had to comprehend and to understand the negative aspects or the shadow of the Divine Mother that the Master Samael also explains in many of his books. So we were saying that the wife of the Divine Mother Death is Saturn, Shiva, Bina, the Holy Spirit, which is the destroyer. The universe is destroyed, of course, in a very didactic way, at the end of every Maha Manvantara. In order to initiate the Maha Pralaya, or Great Night. And we were stating that the Divine Mother Death and the Divine Mother Nature have their shadows, which are worshipped by the black magicians. Because the black magicians, the fornicators, the black tantric, also worship the Divine Mother. That's why in Hinduism it is stated that Shiva had also two tenebrous or negative aspects of the Divine Mother, Kali and Durga. Kali is the regent of this dark age of Kali Yuga, which is worshipped by the fornicators. Kali symbolizes a death, of course. Divine Mother Death takes in that shadow aspect her children into the abyss, into hell, in order to destroy them. Divine Mother Death works positively in those initiates that walk in Tantra, white Tantra, in order to self-realize them. But also in her negative aspect, works negatively, in order to destroy the black tantric people, the fornicators in the abyss, So then you find the unmanifested divine mother Kundalini, Maha Kundalini, in the center of that graphic. And then we have the divine mother nature, symbolized by Diana, and that who has many names in different religions. The divine mother death, which works always in a cosmic way and even individually. She is in charge of the annihilation or the transformation of matter into energy, energy into matter. And we say that the negative aspects of the divine mother are worshipped, I repeat, by the tantrics, the shadow of nature, Kali. But Durga also, because we have our own divine mother Kundalini, our own particular individual mother. That's the fourth aspect of the divine mother. That fourth aspect is in the individual monad of each one of us. As we have our own particular individual Shiva inside, we have our own particular divine mother. She is a creator of this physical body that we have. She always created the different physical bodies that we had in different reincarnations in the womb of our beloved physical mothers that we had in different reincarnations. So we will say that in her, the Divine Mother Kundalini individually, of each one of us, is represented all the mothers that we had and that we have right now. She's the one that can help us, because in the same way that a tide comes as a big wave from the ocean and lashes the shore, the beach, in the same way our own particular individual mother emerges from the unknowable divine mother and becomes individually, in each one of us, becomes individual. So this is how you have to understand that our divine mother is an aspect of the great unmanifested mother and the manifested mother and the mother death. But we have another, of course, aspect that we have to study very careful, which is commonly called the fairy godmother, which always appears and helps the magicians or the beginners in magic. People wonder, who is this? The Taoists call her Quan Chi Yin. Chi, of course, is the energy, as you know, that is related with all the functions of the different organs, systems that we have within. We have, for instance, this instinctual force, intelligence working as a Chi, intelligent energy, in the physical organism. It's called the instinctual intelligence, which is placed, of course, as you know, in the Muladhara chakra. Acts instinctually, but we want to put her to act consciously. So we have to awake her. Of course, the wife of that instinctual force that we have in the coccyx, that we have to awake with, which is the Kundalini, as her husband. This is Shiva in the pineal gland. The union of Shiva Shakti in the spinal column is what gives to the magician power. That instinctual force gives us sexual potence. We call here that intelligence, which is called, I repeat, the fairy godmother, Quan Chi Yin. And there are many masters in Taoism, as you know, that utilize that energy, which is unconscious for us. But if you want to work and to control the gunas, all that instinctual part has to be active, willingly controlled by our consciousness. It's impossible to admit that a Paramartha Satya has no control over the instinctual force. That's why we have to control the instinctual force into conscious force, intuition. And that's precisely the Divine Mother, which is the Master Samael talks about her, that is small like a gnome. But it's related, of course, with our instinctual force. I repeat, if you study Taoism, Quan Chi Jin, there's a very good aspect in which this religion studied a lot. But we have to understand and comprehend that there are a lot of black tantric Taoists that are teaching black tantra, because that aspect or instinctual force can be awakened in a negative way. And that's why that what we call the Kunda buffer organ. Remember that the Divine Mother is sleeping 3.5 times in the Muladhara chakra. And only by awakening the Muladhara chakra is how we take control of those three gunas in ourselves. But the Divine Mother could be awakened, as we know, in a negative way. When it's awakened in a negative way as a Kunda buffer organ, then the tantric, the black magician, condemns themselves to death into the abyss. Because that force, when developed in a negative way, sends the soul into the abyss. And the Kunda buffer organ, which is the negative aspect of the Divine Mother, destroys the ego very painfully in those failure souls that refuse to walk in the self-realization of the being. To understand these five aspects is indispensable. It's very important, because every authentic initiate has to work with these five aspects. This is called the Penta Alpha. Remember that the letter Alpha in Latin is related with Aqua. Again, that's why we said Penta Alpha, or the five aspects of creation. The five aspects of Aqua, Mary, or Mem, which in Sanskrit is called the Akasa. This Akasa, as you know, is a modification of Prakriti. And those elements are called Vikritis, is precisely the different modifications of the Tattvas that are infinite. That's why the Master Samael tells us that the Pentalpha, the five, is equal to the eight. Or the symbol of the infinite is equal to the Pentalpha. By studying this infinite, which is the eight, but the Master says brain, heart, and sex, or the three primary forces, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's the Holy Eight, in which the Divine Mother is synthesized her five aspects in order to create and to develop and to give into every monad knowledge. Here you understand and comprehend why the Divine Mother exerts a special place in creation. Not a single god in the universe can display powers, omniscience, wisdom, without the help of the Divine Mother. Because they acquire that when they control her three gunas, which are the infinite possibilities within her womb, that are only possible to awake with the three primary forces that emerges from her womb. This is how you understand that infinite is equal to five, or the pentalpha, the pentagram, is equal to the sign of the infinite. So the Divine Mother is that primordial substance of matter, has no form. In any of his five aspects, has no form, but can represent herself in front of any mystic in any form. That's why all religions represent these aspects of the Divine Mother in different ways. And the simple way is the cow of five legs, which are worshipped in the Hindustan, in India. But in any religion that you inquire, you find always whether the cosmic aspect or the unmanifested aspect of the Divine Mother, or Mother Death, which is called, for instance, among the Aztecs, Cuatlicue. And the Divine Mother, individual mother, that obviously each one of us has his own Divine Mother. And she has a name in each one of us. It means that my Divine Mother has a name, and your Divine Mother has a name too. And that is only known to each one of us. But in Gnosticism, we call her, in any aspect, Ram-io. Because it's a symbol, of course, of the duality, of the female aspect of divinity. When we enter into this path of self-realization, obviously, the great goal is the goal of the Bodhisattva. Of course, the Divine Mother develops in different ways in different monads. But the Master Samael on Veor is our walker of the straight path, the path that takes us to the Absolute in order to become Paramartasatyas. And that's why the doctrine that we teach is the doctrine of the Paramartha Satyas, the doctrine of the Bodhisattvas, that walk in order to acquire that goal. Of course, the Buddha Gautama Sakyamuni, a great Bodhisattva of Christ, taught the Eightfold Path, which is intimately related with the sign of the infinite, or the Holy Eight, in which we have to develop the eight qualities or the eight virtues related with the path of the Bodhisattva. And that is why the Master Jesus of Nazareth, who is, of course, the highest initiate, who is at the top in the pyramid of all of those self-realized masters, because as you know, Master Jesus of Nazareth, Avramento, he acquired the title or the level of Paramartasatya among all the self-realized masters. He's the only one that we know at that level. The other that are in that level are within the Ain. I don't know of any other Paramartasatya that abandoned the aim in order to teach the path. So therefore, the doctrine of the Master Jesus synthesized the whole path of the Bodhisattva. And that's why when we study the four Gospels, especially the Gospel of Matthew, we find there how you call the eight blessings. Or the Sermon of the Mount. When the Master Jesus starts talking about as you see, for instance, here in the graphic also, you find the third graphic in which you find the Buddha Gautama showing the way in which he was tempted by the three gunas. And in order to control the three gunas, he taught the Eightfold Path of the Bodhisattva, which is the same that the Master Jesus of Nazareth taught in the Sermon of the Mount. The way in which the Bodhisattva has to work in order to develop and to control the three gunas. As you know, when somebody has no control of the three gunas, or those possibilities of the mother creation, mechanicity, which is ignorance of these three gunas, creates, of course, negative aspects of the gunas. That's why we say that the three gunas are the three perverse modifications of these three gunas in the human being. I mean, the three demons that we have, or the three traitors, in other words. This is what I'm specifying here. The three traitors that we always talk, or that betray Jesus, which are Judas, Pilate, and Caiaphas, are the three aspects of the three gunas, which are, of course, pervert within each one of us. And also that's why you find that the Buddha Gautama is also tempted by three women, which represent the three gunas, which are the three crystallizations that are made because of ignorance that exists within each one of us. That's why it is stated that in the book of Revelation, that from the mouth of the dragon, you see, in this case we will say that the dragon that we have in the sex, and from the mouth of the beast that we have in the heart, and from the mouth of the false prophet that we have in the head, the intellect, emerge three filthy spirits with the form of a frog. And these three filthy spirits are the three traitors, the three negative aspects of these three gunas, which in the Old Testament among Moses is called Kore, Datan, and Abiram. And that in Masonry, they call it the three assassins of Hiram, or Chiram Osiris. These three assassins that kill the inner god of each one of us. You will wonder, how does these three traitors kill my god? If you understand and we explained already that our Glorian, our own particular god, our own particular ray, enters into our physical body through the three nervous systems. Cerebrospinal nervous system, grand sympathetic, and parasympathetic nervous systems. Those are the three primary forces of our own particular god that enter in every physical organism. But it's what do we do? What do we do with those three primary forces? We kill them with our own particular gunas, perverted gunas, with our own three traitors that we have within, which are related with the ego. And we transform the energy of God into demons, egos, that we have within. This is how we kill Christ. Because remember that Christ is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Enters into us in order to give us life. That's why he says, it is written in the Gospel of John, that it came into his own. The world was created by him, talking about the three primary forces. But the world never knew him, because the three traitors destroyed that solar force and crucified the Lord, killed it in each one of us. This is how we kill our own internal God. That's why we had to kill the three traitors. By killing the three traitors, then our God is dead as well, but symbolically resuscitate. And then we can exclaim, "The king is dead, long live the king." When we acquire self-realization, the self-realization of the being. This is how you have to understand how in every single religion you find these three perverse gunas or traitors or enemies of God, because they abide within each one of us. So that's why the Master Jesus teaches the path of the Bodhisattva in the Sermon of the Mount. The Sermon of the Mount. And he says, "Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted." And of course, this blessing is related in Buddhism with that we call upright understanding or a spiritual view, in which we have to understand that those that mourn are precisely the initiates that enter into the direct path and that are willingly suffering their own path. And of course, the comforted, as is written in the Bible, "If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you ever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it sees him not, neither knows him. But you know him, because he is the Holy Spirit, the Comforted. For he dwells within you and shall be in you if you develop it. I will not have you comfortless. I will come to you." This is how it's written in John. The Comforter is the Holy Spirit. So those who mourn, of course, have to be comforted. But the only way to be comforted is by working with that. Because the mystery of that is the mystery of Bina, in which the Comforted, which is the Divine Mother Kundalini, becomes pregnant by the grace and power of the Holy Spirit. Then the divine word understanding Christ descends in the Bodhisattva, because it is necessary for the Lord to descend, to enter, to abide in our spirit. In our soul, in our mind and body, in order for him, through the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, to work the great work. And that is the first blessing. Those who mourn, those who want to self-realize themselves, those who want to develop their own Father who is in heaven, they can do it by receiving the doctrine of that which is Gnosis. The other virtue of the Eightfold Path is upright love, peace, which is also acquired for meditation. In Christianity, the Master Jesus says, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy." When we study Kabbalah, we know very well that mercy is Hesed, which receives another name, Gedulah, which is love. So the Son of God, Atman, the ineffable, the Spirit in each one of us, is El, God, and receives the name in the Sephiroth, Chesed, which is mercy, and love, which is Gedulah. That's why sometimes you find as Gedulah, sometimes as Chesed. So, who are the merciful? The merciful are those that work with their inner being, that allow their inner spirit to work. And for that, we have to meditate, because meditation is a technique in order to develop conscious love. Because remember that love is law, but conscious love, not mechanical love. That's why you see there in the second graphic, that is the Samaritan. It is written there that a lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And he said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read?" And he answered, "You shall have the Lord your, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." Of course, that is a work of Atman, because he is the only one, his love, he's the only one capable of loving without reward, because the ego in us is always wanting reward. And that's why the parable of the Samaritan, it is written there that the Samaritan in the Bible that helped that man that was hurt in the road, on the road. But in order to help, it's just, if you read the parable, you have to understand that the Samaritan is applying love in the conscious way. And is giving unto that poor man, which is wounded, the necessary aids. Is given treatment in the body, also in his soul, and even paying the inn in order to stay there. So that is conscious love. Because many times we say that if you give alms to a person that smokes marijuana, he's going to go and buy marijuana. Chesed, the intimate, the innermost, never do that. Never does that. Because he knows how to do mercy. This is called compassion as well. Many people always talk about compassion and mercy, and then demand that the other person spoil the other. That's not mercy. That's to spoil somebody else. The real mercy, the real love, comes from the innermost. The Son of God, he knows how to do love, but conscious love, cognizant, not mechanical, nor emotional. That's why it is written that is the outcome of meditation, comprehension. Now, the third is upright mindfulness, awareness. Consciousness. And then we arrive, of course, at Geburah. Geburah is the divine soul, the conscience, spiritual soul. Geburah is, of course, called the aspect of the soul, which is called Neshama, in which we find the consciousness of God, which is, of course, justice. And it's because If the innermost applies love, he applies with justice. Sometimes individuals call for assistance, help. But it is written that the Master Jesus said, related with Geburah, blessed are they which hunger and thirst after righteousness. They want justice. And everyone wants justice. You know, karma is applied to us very drastically in the path. And sometimes there are situations in which we ask for justice, help. But when we are in this path, we have to understand that the Master says, blessed are the which that hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. But the Master Jesus says, think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I said unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tiniest bit shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men, so he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I said unto you, that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, ye shall not in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. And if you have read there, which is in the internet, you will understand that there are certain situations in our life in which we demand for justice because we believe that we are just. Nobody is just. Just is only God. That's why I remember that in other gospel is written in a different way. The same man or the another man asks Jesus, good master. And then the master says, what do you call me good? Good is only God. In other words, just. The one that applies justice. Only God can apply justice in the right way. And that is precisely in Geburah. Sometimes we don't like the way in which life is treating us. Even in this path, when we are delivering the knowledge, we are helping humanity. And meanwhile, when the karma is applied to us and it's very severe, we protest. And the problem is that we have the custom of pointing other people of our own misery. If we suffer, we are not the one that have to be punished, but others. Because it's not my fault. It's other people's fault. And that's why the Master says, whosoever break all of these commandments, what commandments he's talking about? The Ten Commandments. Did we break those commandments? Obviously, all of us broke those commandments. So therefore, we are going to receive our punishment according to the law. And they are, of course, as we know very well, related with karma, saya and kamaduro, unnegotiable karmas. And unfortunately, we are always involved in all of this. And we receive pain and suffering. But we think that we don't deserve it. Because other people believe that this thing should be in this way or in this other way. But justice is justice. And whatever is happening is justice. So therefore, if we can help, we help. But if the law is there, no matter what we do, even the Master says, when we do chains of healing, we ask for the masters of the medicine, heal this soul that his body is sick. But if the law says, yeah, it will be dead, has to die. Then the master of medicine accelerate death, because nobody can break the law. But the people that are suffering, their relatives, will say, oh, this is injustice, because we love our relative. And sometimes that's why when we pray for healing, the best healing that any soul can receive is death, because it rests. But nobody understands that. That's why we have to develop that consciousness, understanding, comprehension, when we are asking for righteousness, because we shall be filled according to the law, not according to the ego. The other blessing says, but in Buddhism, upright action. We have to write upright action in the walk of the self-realization. Christianity says, Master Jesus said, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. And here we find, of course, how Tifereth, the human soul, has to humble in order to receive the verdict of the law. And of course, Tifereth is the one that deals with the souls. He's a shepherd, has his disciples. He's the inner man that is awakening in the sixth dimension. But in the third dimension, the souls are sleeping. And it is written there that Jesus said to them, you will all fall away, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, Tifereth, the human soul. Strike it with karma, of course, according to the law. And the sheep will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go before you into Galilee. Peter, which is faith in the pineal gland, that aspect that we have within, says, even though they all fall away, I will not. This is what you have, all the resolution. Every time all the Gnostics fall down, I will not, because I am resolute to walk. I have willpower, my faith. And Jesus said to Peter, truly I say to you, this very night, which means the night of ordeals, before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times. Do you understand that? To deny the Lord three times? It's because we have three brains. Peter is willpower, faith in the pineal gland. But unfortunately, cannot control the three brains yet because of karma. And he says, no, I will not deny you. But before the verb, before the word, the rooster, which is a symbol of the Christ, crossed twice, resurrection, you will deny me three times. But Peter said vehemently, if I must die with you, I will not deny you. This is what we always said with our own heart. And after that is written, and they all say the same. All the initiates always say the same. I will not deny you. Even if I go to jail. Even if they kill me. But unfortunately, we have the three traitors inside. Because after that, remember, that the first traitor comes, Judas. And after that appear Pilate and then Caiaphas. And Peter is there always, hearing and denying. Willpower, trying to control the demons, but the demons have more power. You can read the following there in order not to make this lecture so long. Because it is, that's why it is written there in the website. Let us go now into the number 5, upright way of thinking. We have to have upright way of thinking. We put there nous, motives. Nous is mind. But remember, that is the abstract mind, the spiritual mind that we have in the left ventricle of the heart. That has to control the mind. In order to have upright thought, we have to put that mind that we have, which is mechanical, under the surface of nous, the spiritual mind. Because I repeat, nous means mind, but spiritual mind. And Jesus says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Who are the poor in spirit? Those that are humble. Those that have a lot of faith, that do not have pride, vanity, self-esteem, self-importance, arrogance. Those are the ones that are poor in spirit. Because in order to receive the kingdom of heaven, we have to be poor. We have to have our mind empty. The kingdom of heaven, of course, is related with our own particular God. Our God is the king. A divine mother is the queen. How does God, as male, and our God is female, divine mother, will enter into a mind which is full of pride, arrogance, a mystic pride, mystic vanity? Obviously, that mind is not poor. And the Master Samael explains very carefully there in Revolutionary Psychology how a rich man cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. People are mistaken and think that to be a rich is, I mean, to have dollars or to have gold. No. There are many humble masters that have God within and they have a lot of money. The Count of Saint Germain, for instance, is a master that has God within, and he can make diamonds with alchemy. He can make, transform physical lead into gold. He can control all the wealth of the earth. But obviously, they are not greedy. Even though they have all the earth under their power, they prefer to live as vagabonds. They don't care about power. But the ego cares about power. So all of the people in this earth are not poor, are rich. We are rich, psychologically speaking. We have the mind filled with a lot of power and a lot of arrogance. That's why the Master Samael explains that in order to be poor, you have to clean your mind. In order not to hunt for power. There are even Gnostics that are hunting for power. It's too sad to admit it, but Gnosticism, the Gnostic Church, opened the doors for everybody. But everybody has ego. Everybody has a lot of arrogance, pride, and vanity. And they only want power in the earth, because the mind always exercises power in this three-dimensional world. And there you find the different groups of Gnosticism fighting for power, for supremacy. And that, of course, is not the path of the Bodhisattva. And some of them have transformed the path of the Bodhisattva, the path of Christ, into the path of Robin Hood, which is still the rich in order to make rich others, physically speaking, and to exploit what they don't belong to them. This wisdom belongs to Christ, to the kingdom of heaven, and he is given to everybody. Nobody has the right to say that has copyrights of anything. That's why the Master Samael, authentic Bodhisattva, never demanded copyrights of his books, because he understood that the doctrine belongs to the universe, belongs to Christ. And that's why he delivered it to the poor. Let us go down and let us find now the sixth. In Buddhism, upright feeling, which is related with speech, truthfulness. How does upright feeling is related with speech and truthfulness? You know very well that the negative emotions turn the people into a liar. And that is written in that lecture that the master explains, and how if we are victim of negative emotions, we lie not only to ourselves, but to others. And in this day and age, unfortunately, people are convinced of their own lies. Christianity says, blessed are the pure in heart, because in the heart we have the pure feelings. For they shall see God, because God is the truth. The Father is the truth. And the Master explains very well that when we lie unconsciously or consciously, we disconnect ourselves from our own particular God, which is the truth. That's why it is related with that commandment that said, thou shalt not lie. Only those that have control in their feelings and do not have resentment against anybody are the ones that can see their inner God, the inner spirit, the inner Christ. That's why it is written that the Jews came around Jesus and said unto him, how long dost thou make us to doubt? If thou be the Christ, tell us plainly. And Master Jesus says, I told you, but you don't believe it. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. But ye believe not, because ye are not of my sheep. And I said unto you, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. How does the sheep, the soul, the burrata, will follow the Lord? If we hear the voice of nous, which is in the left ventricle of the heart, if we have positive feelings. But if we are filled with resentment, obviously, we are not following nous. We are following the mind. And the feelings, the negative feelings, turn us liars. And how sad it is to discover all of a sudden, without any warning, that we were lying to ourselves and to others, because we were believing and not paying attention to our own feelings, our own resentment, pride and vanity and self-importance, whatever, but we were always pointing the brother. Well, excuse me, you have a little trash in your eye. This is precisely what we always said. Who cares what the other people have? If we have a trunk or splinter. You have a little splinter in your eye? No. If I have a trunk in my eye, why should I care about yours? I have to take a care about my ego. But people think here that in Gnosticism, they come and say, I have a list of my egos. Can you please sit down and comprehend my egos and ask annihilation to your Divine Mother, so I can advance in this path? That's impossible. The one that has to comprehend their egos is each one of us. And to ask for annihilation individually. Nobody here advances because other people say, oh, you are advancing. That's something very individual. And if we lie to ourselves, thinking that we are the Emperor Nero, and then we are, of course, making false images based on negative feelings. And then God withdraws. He says, well, why am I going to mingle with this who is already a great master? I am the master of this soul, but this soul thinks that this pride, this vanity, is a master. So God doesn't go inside. That's why it is written that the Atum Nous and the Father are one. And you have to read what is written there in the website in order to comprehend and to understand each one of these aspects of the Eightfold Path. We are arriving at a very important one, which is the seventh, which is called upright effort or exertion. And we wrote there body cardinals, because it's related with the vital body, obviously, with the asad, with the energy that we have. The Lord says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. The ones that are not peacemakers, how do they call them? We call them violent. Whether you are a violent or a peacemaker, you make violence, war, you are not a peacemaker. But you have to be in peace with yourself. And in order to be in peace with ourselves, we have to apply in physically, understanding that the vital body is the superior aspect of the physical body. In the vital body, which is the Asad, we understand the parable that the Master Jesus explained about the parable of the talents, in which you find the graphic there, as you follow the graphic, this man who is a rich man and has many maids, servants, and he gives different coins or talents to each one of them, because he is living. And when he returns, he applies, of course, is asking, what do you do with the talents that I give you? And the man says, well, I invested that, and now I have 10. You gave me 5, I have 10. But then while I'm on them, I said, well, you give me just 1, but I was afraid because you are very strict, your law, you know, so I just hid it. And now here is your talent, right? I don't even touch it. I said, oh, you are a lazy one. You don't even do anything with the talent that I gave you. How do I will put in front of my businesses? But if you double the talent that I gave you, of course, you will come with me. Which means this is the way in which each one of us as soul is given those talents. Who do you think those talents are? We understand always, and we repeat, that the prana, the energy that comes into the physical body, enters to the three primary forces, the three brains. And of course, we have to acquire or to develop in our path, because we are working with the Kundalini, that akasa or power that we developed by doing pranayama or doing sexual magic is directly enriching the senses. We have to understand that each one of the five senses or five talents, as is written in the Bible, we have to duplicate them. And that's why we have to acquire mastery over our five senses, which are related with the five tattvas. If you master one of the senses, then you will acquire an internal talent. For instance, the sight. The sight is related with the tatua tejas. Because you know that the tatuas are related with the four dimensions, with the vital body. So, tejas, which is the light of the sun, enters into our eyes through light and color. So that's why we have to educate our sight. in order only to see the beauty. Because that goes into the mind. And that precisely that gives us our willpower to do what we have to do. Because it's related, the inner sight, as you know, is related with the pineal gland. If through the eyes we see the light in this physical world, through the pineal gland we see the internal light. And if we educate our sight, this is how we are going to make internally positive images. That's why it is written that the master explains that we always have the ability of seeing the beauty of things, not the ugliness of it. Even we had to learn how to see the beauty within the ugliness in order to educate our sight. We had to learn how to see women in order not to create lust inside of us. By developing and acquiring a good sight, by educating our eyes, this is how we develop internal sight. Because the pineal gland is an internal eye. But if we have negative images and we are always seeing the ugliness of everything, obviously the light which is in the internal eye is darkness. And we are not going to see the positive images of the internal worlds if we do not educate our sight. Related with the Tawa Tejas. With the Tawa Akasa, we find that it is in relation with sound. It is in relation with the ear. With what we hear. And directly related with, in other words, when we apply the chakras with the thyroid gland. The word that we hear has to be comprehended. That's the word. That's why the akasa is related with the ear and related also with the mind. With the type of knowledge that we are listening here, we are, of course, developing knowledge in our mind. So we have to educate also our ears in order to develop a good mind, to understand the beauty of things. You see, this is how the eye and the ear are related. Because the sound, the music that we hear develops the positive aspect of the mind. We have to learn how to listen beautiful words. We have to avoid as much as we can gossip, criticism, because that enters into the ear and makes or disturbs the images that we have of people. And this is how the mind, after that, is projecting things and creating things which are not true. So if we educate our ears, and then we will have a positive mind. Remember that mens sana in corpore sano. Physically, we are what we are internally. Or the exterior is the reflection of the interior. But the senses bring into the internal mind many things, whether for the eye or through the ear. That's why it is good also to listen good things and to reject criticism. Fortunately, this is very common in this day and age. That's why the mind is filthy. This is the akasa related with the sound. If we educate our ear, then we have another talent that we are duplicating. You see, the duplication of the talent is inside in the psyche, not outside. But if we like to listen metallic music, rock and roll, you know, that garbage, how are we going to develop that? We are going to destroy the talent. But not to double it. And then we have the other talent, which is related with the smell, the sense of smell, which is directly related with the other sense, which is taste. You see, smell is related, in this case, with the tatwa of the earth, prithvi. And taste is related with the tatwa apas. Both are related. We will say that these two senses are related with the two guardian angels, which are always at the door in order not to admit negative forces of that which is ugly. Like in the ear, for instance, which is related with the akasa, there's a guardian there in the ear, an atomic force, that do not admit to enter into the monad. That's why Philip is related with comprehension. The monad doesn't take which is not comprehended, which is not truth. So the guardian angel in the ear rejects all the lies, all the falsity, never goes into the monad. It will go into the mind, but not into the monad. Because that guardian in the ear, when allowed, those negative information going into the monad. Everything that is positive goes into the monad. This is how God separates everything. And in the hearing, the smell, and the taste, you find the other two guardians that only admit what is pleasant, what is good. In the same way that we choose what we eat, the same way we have to choose what we take, what we taste. We had to understand that many things have taste, internal taste. Sometimes you said, I like how this tastes internally. It's positive for my soul. Or you say sometimes, I like the smell of this. Smell good. Even though you are not smelling it physically, but somehow you are smelling the positive aspect. So, because smelling is related with emotions. So everything that smells good is positive emotion. But everything that smells bad is negative emotion. So you find here how the senses are related with the tatwas. Of course, the sense of touch is related with the physical body. Because it's the sense that develop love. As you know, the most sensitive organ of the sense of touch is the sexual organ. That's why by acquiring development of the sense of touch in the positive way, we develop love. It is also stated that the hands are the physical expression of the mind. Of what is written, that the name of God is written on the forehead of those that are chosen, and also in the hands. But as well, the sign of the beast is in the forehead and in the hands as well. Because to the hand, we act, we touch, we express love. That's why Master Jesus says in one of the Gospels, when you are doing and exercising love with your actions, with your touch, do not let your left hand to know what your right hand is doing. Because right hand is positive actions in relation with touch. And also, of course, this is why we have to develop this sense internally. When you are developing love, is by transmuting the instincts related with touch and with a sense of taste. So if you study carefully each one of the five senses, then you discover how they are related with your internal development and how the talents will duplicate if you know how to educate the senses. Because the senses are nothing else than a modification of that substance that we call Akasa, which is the Divine Mother, which is related with the instincts. If by educating the senses, we start developing internally in relation with the internal bodies as well. That's why it is indispensable in Gnosticism to understand this. It's not just learning how to eat or how to breathe. Because remember that the fire that enters into the nostrils, when we apply the pranayama, goes into any of the three aspects that we have, the three brains, according to our thoughts and feelings. If you have good thoughts, good concentration, the energy, the sexual force that we are transmuting goes into the head. If we have good emotions, goes into the heart. But if we are thinking lustfully, obviously, the whole energy will go into the sex. So everything depends on how we control the respiration in order to guide the force, the prana that is entering into our three brains. This is how we control the gunas, or the beginning of the control of the gunas is the control of the senses. Because remember, the three gunas are the three modifications of the principles of the Divine Mother. And when we start working with the transmutation, these three gunas becomes to express themselves in vikritis, which in Sanskrit means the modifications or the tattvas, in other words, which express themselves to the senses. And by controlling the senses is how we control the force of the Divine Mother. Do you understand that? And of course, this is how we duplicate our life, physically speaking. Because we are increasing the energy. It's how the body cardinals are increased. And this is how they are, as Master says, for instance, talking in the forum, the people are so concerned with that Lamasri exercises. What we are talking here is very well known by those monks. Because in order to increase the body cardinals is to increase life. It's not just by doing the exercises mechanically. You have to educate your senses, you have to do many things in order to develop the talents. So when your inner God comes to you into the physical body, they will reward you. It says, oh, my son, I gave you five senses, and now I see that you doubling. You have more senses inside because you know how to handle the body cardinals, you know how to handle the tattvas, the modifications of my wife, which is Devi Kundalini. And we arrive at the end of the eighth, which is upright livelihood. Livelihood. Or surviving. Christianity says, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness sake, for there is the kingdom of heaven. So, when we are being persecuted in this physical plane, is when we are being tempted. Remember, temptation is fire. The triumph of a temptation is light. In any type of work that we work, we are always persecuted. Sometimes consciously, sometimes unconsciously. because people with their ego come and tempt you to do what you shouldn't do. We have to have a right, upright livelihood. To begin, we can understand that the parable that says there that we cannot serve two lords, Mammon and God, meaning that we cannot serve the wealth of this physical plane. All the wealth. We had to serve the wealth of God. So we had to develop and not to worry about what type of food are we going to eat, what type of clothes are we going to wear, or where are we going to live. Because God always knows what we need. But remember that as Jesus was tempted in the wilderness of his life, as well, any initiate will be tempted in this path, because everyone is developing his skills in order to survive in this world, in order to make money. And there are people there that do not care about this path, so they will persecute you, consciously or unconsciously. Even without wanting to persecute you, will tempt you. But you always have to realize that you are between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of the earth. And if you choose always to follow your God, God will provide you in many ways. Do you have questions? Yeah. No, it's not the same. No. Your inner being has a name. Your inner God, the positive, I mean the masculine aspect. But the name of the Divine Mother is different. Usually, for instance, the Master Samael on the earth gave the name of his inner being. But he never reveals the name of his Divine Mother. Well, when you discover it, you will see. It's the name of God. The Master Samael says, for instance, in Gnosticism, we call it Ram-Io. Maybe is that the name of the Divine Mother of Master Samael? Who knows? We cannot assert because he never says. Well, the only one that I will name it in the beginning is the Master Quan Yin, which is a female master that self-realized, and whose name is Quan Chi Yin, and who represents that. So I assume, I am not asseverating here, that that's the name of the master, because you find many times the graphic or the figure of this master as masculine. But they said that his last incarnation was a female. But Quan Chi Yin represents, of course, the Divine Mother. Why not the name of that particular being in itself?
You're saying that Quan Yin would be the inner being?
You see, Yin, for instance, in Taoism, is a feminine aspect. And Chi is the energy. So when you say Qi Yin, you are saying the feminine aspect of Qi.
So it's very related to
the name. Of course, it's absolutely related with Quan Chi Yin, with that aspect in the physical body, which Taoist works very well. There is a lot of wisdom, for instance, among the, how you call that, Tai Chi, or this other healing way with touch, Qigong, whatever, when they utilize the energy of the Divine Mother. This is what they're doing. Dealing with that instinctual force, which is in every physical body. But I'm telling you, and as depends according to our behavior, how to control the positive or the negative aspect, because you cannot wake negatively, right? By fornicating. The Divine Mother loves so much the soul that when that tantric work with Black Tantra, she polarizes negatively in order to help the soul in hell to annihilate that ego, in order to liberate it. But in that way, that soul doesn't acquire wisdom. It's just a failure. But the Divine Mother never abandons the soul. So that's why all the fornicators in this physical world that won't follow the path will go to hell. And their Divine Mother will polarize negatively in order to help them there. In the eighth circle, will disintegrate them.
Is Santa Maria the opposite of Ave Maria? Santa Maria is one of
the Master Samael explains in the book of Perfect Matrimony that Santa Maria is the shadow of the Virgin Mary, the negative aspect of nature that the black magicians worship. And that in India is called Kali, because Kali has two aspects, the positive and the negative. But now everybody is worshiping Kali, and also Durga, which is the negative aspect. This is related with the Kunda buffer organ. Yeah.
So even within that same, you're showing the duality.
Yeah, it's a duality, of course, but in the last synthesis is the Prakriti. That's why the Master Samael in Mexico, he was telling us. We have to learn how to see the Divine Mother in every woman. And then he says, he added, well, you will tell me, well, but there is a lot of whores, prostitutes there. How are we going to see? And then I will tell you, he says, who are we to judge? If they are choosing the abyss, let them go. But the Divine Mother goes with them. And she will annihilate them as failures, but she will do it.
What about in the case of empty houses? Does the Divine Mother still stay within an empty house, even though the Adam...
Empty house is called physically a person whose soul is no longer inside the body, but in the abyss. So that soul, of course, is the Kunda buffer, is the ego with the Kunda buffer organ. Obviously, the Divine Mother is polarized negatively and will kill him down there.
She, no matter what, stays with everybody.
Yeah, okay. And will liberate him. But in this physical world, you will see the physical body of the person is an empty house, meaning that the owner, the soul owner of that physical body is no longer there. It's just maybe a demon or one ego, the person, just in order to fulfill the karma. So, yeah, what is your question?
The course began describing hydrogens and the descent of Christ. So how does the student relate that with the Divine Mother and the Eightfold Path?
Well, the primordial substance, which is Prakriti, modifies in what we call Vikritis. And those Vikritis are synthesized in the 12 types of hydrogen, which are the base of all type of matters. Because in this physical world, we know only the physical matter. But in occultism, in alchemy, we study the hydrogen as the first crystallization of the Prakriti. So the hydrogen in itself, which represents the three primary forces, the crystallization of that, is modified, decretis, in 12 types of hydrogen, which are associated with the 12 sephiroth, taking into account the Ein Sof Or and the Ein Sof. Because within the Ein Sof Or is that immortal nature within the absolute, the first crystallization of the unmanifested, which is also an unmanifested universe. But even within the Ein Sof, which is unmanifested, you find a type of nature which is unknowable, which exists only within the mind of the inhabitants of the Ein Sof. The Master says are like Edens within the Ein Sof that exist within the mind of the gods, which are taken from the unmanifested Prakriti. But if we take a flower from that universe and we put it outside into the universe, I mean, this created world, will disappear. Yeah? Will disappear. Because that type of nature, which is unknowable, is not in this universe, is, while the nature here in this universe exists. You see? So we have there 12 types of hydrogens within the Ein Sof Or, and the 10 Sephiroth. This is how the Prakriti really modifies. This is, I repeat, this is what we call Vikritis.
How does that relate to Christ and the Eightfold? I'm asking for basically a summary of the whole course, how all these pieces fit together. Why is it one course? Why is this lecture today the transformation of energy?
Enfolds in the sense that what is that is precisely what we are looking for, the control of the five aspects of the Divine Mother. When we control the five aspects of the Divine Mother, and then we control the three gunas of the Divine Mother that express themselves in different aspects, in each one of her aspects, and Vikritis, which are the modifications of that gunas in the tattvas. So the Master, really, as you see in many books of the Master, he always explained that the Master is really the control of matter, which is really the control of Prakriti. When you acquire the control of Prakriti, the Divine Mother, who is creation, and then you are self-realized. And that's why the acquiring of this self-realization is in different steps, in which you control the energy, transform the energy into matter, the matter into energy, by consciously knowing how to do it. I mean, but it's, of course, the monad, the one that does it. And one begins, as we said, by educating the five senses, by transmuting the sexual energy. And little by little, with comprehension, you are developing, until you acquire the level of Paramartha Satya, which is completely the 100% of control of the energy and matter. Because energy and matter are related with the universe. When you have absolute control of energy and matter, transmutation of matter into energy and energy into matter, in the 12 basic hydrogens, and all of the kingdoms, and all the tree of life, and then you acquire complete control of the three gunas, which are the modifications of that substance that we call matter, and the application of that energy. And then you acquire the title of Paramartha Satya. And you disappear from the universe, because you already know what you didn't know. In other words, each one of us has the same potency of a Paramartha Satya. But the problem is that we don't know it.
Potentiality,
yeah. The same potentiality of a Paramartha Satya. But in order to develop that potency, potential, you see, we have the same potentiality. It's not potentiality.
Potential.
Yeah, we have the same potential in order to become that. But obviously, that's why, you see, many cosmos creators return different Mahamambantaras. Because a cosmos creator enters into the 12th Aeon, which is the Ein Sof. What they want is to enter into the 13, which is Ein. And every cosmic day, they try to acquire complete control with the three gunas. But any disequilibrium of the three gunas push them out of the Ein Sof in order to appear in creation. You see how difficult it is. That's why I admire the Master Jesus, because he abandoned the absolute by will. But he is an habitant already, means that he controls completely the three gunas. So in the universe, there are many gods, of course, that have different qualities, control of the three gunas. And there are those that really have no control at all of them, which are called demons. Well, that which we call compassion as an expression of what he did to abandon the absolute in order to come into this universe, we can call it compassion. But I think that it's beyond compassion. It's beyond that we understand as compassion.
But that's the bodhicitta ideal.
Oh, yeah, of course. The bodhicitta is a complete awakening consciousness. It's a awakening consciousness that controls. Right? It's nous.
Bodhicitta is beyond the three gunas, then. It's ultimate.
Yeah. The bodhicitta is the king.
That's the point I'm trying to get at.
Yeah. The bodhicitta is the king. Or bodhicitta. That's the king of the gunas.
The awakened mind.
The awakened mind. But it's the abstract mind. Because the master called the bodhicitta wisdom heart. Because in the left ventricle of the heart, we have the atom nous, which is the abstract mind. It's not this mind that we call, because people call citta this mind, intellectual mind, concrete mind. That is not the citta. It's the nous is that citta, right? Bodhicitta. Anyone can be a bodhisattva. But to acquire the bodhicitta is the most difficult thing that you can ever, because it's to acquire control in your gunas. And not only your gunas in your physical body. The Master Jesus of Nazareth acquired control of the gunas in himself. The gunas in hell. The gunas in nature. The gunas in every infinite. And even within the Ein Sof. And that's why he entered into the Ein as Paramartha Satya. Because if he will be in the Ein Sof, will be unbalanced and come out again. You see, this is why the cosmic creators comes into manifestation. They are gods, but still they lack some kind of control of the gunas. That's why they exist. But a Paramartha Satya is a Paramartha Satya. That's why when we said Jesus of Nazareth, this is really something beyond our comprehension. He knows what the absolute is. We don't know. That's what is unknowable. As you see this, it's very complicated. But when you use your heart, you understand that, and you say, okay, let's be patient and do it.
The word Ein Sof, what is the exact translation?
Ein Sof means limitless.
Right, but I'm talking about each word, Ein and Sof.
Ein means nothing.
Nothing.
Ein Sof means limitless. Ein Sof or means limitless light, because or is light.
I know, because I'm thinking, like when we say Sophia, the Sof, what is that?
Well, that word Sophia is a Greek word which means wisdom,
right,
which might be related also with Sof, which is Hebrew. For end.
For end?
Yeah. End or that's what Ein Sof, you see? Limitless. The end of something is the Ein Sof. Now, Sophia is many words related, of course, because Hebrew, Greek, Latin, Chinese are languages which are derived from the golden language, which is related with
the
universe.
Yeah.
Pistis Sophia is from Greek. Pistis.
No, in the book, in the story.
Oh, Pisces Sophia
fell from which aeon?
From the 13 aeon.
Which is the
aeon, yeah.
You
why it fell from there? In order to acquire knowledge. This is precisely all the, how you call the journey of all of us. From the bosom of the Father in order to come into the universe.
But she falls from the 13th into?
To the chaos.
Which is?
The Klipoth. But there are many chaos in Kabbalah. It's a Klipoth. Is the failure, the chaos, everything after this. But it's the chaos in that, is another chaos, where the universe emerges. Because that is in the larynx. In the beginning was the world was with God, and the world was God. That is the chaos of creation of the worlds. And then another chaos that is inside of each one of us, which is a mess. Because the ego in itself is a chaos. And we have to make sense of that chaos through the initiation. That's the great goal. By making light in the darkness. And that is only possible with the Divine Mother. This is how you see. We have to control the Divine Mother through the Divine Mother.
So the transformation of energy, the whole point is working with the Divine Mother.
Yeah. With the Holy Spirit. With Shiva Shakti. That's the goal. To work with Shiva Shakti. That's why you find that the first begotten of creation is Shiva. But Shiva uncreated, Shiva created, and many modifications of Shiva, because as many modifications of Divine Mother, as many modifications of Shiva as well. The whole Da'at Gnosis is based on that. So, if there is no other question, I invite you to meditate and to keep ahead in your work and don't greed for any level. Just awake. Remember that the ego is the one that is always coveting things. The being never covets. One just to develop what belongs to it. And I believe this is the end of this course. And if you have questions, the forum, you can ask questions in the forum and we will try to answer as much as we can.
To learn more about what you learned in this lecture, we invite you to explore the books published by Glorian Publishing, available from booksellers worldwide. You may also be interested in online courses or upcoming retreats, all of which you can learn about at GnosticTeachings.org. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Will you help others to benefit from this knowledge? Most spiritual schools recommend a donation of $10 to $20 per lecture. Every donation helps. Make a donation now at GnosticTeachings.org. Thank you. May all beings be happy.